Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of A Life in Six Songs. I am your host, David Reese, and I'm joined by my co-hosts, Carolina and Raza.
Hi there.
Hello.
For those of you new to the podcast, each week we embark on an epic adventure to find the songs that are stuck to us like audible tattoos that tell the story of who we are and where we've been to help us figure out where we're going. It's a life story told through six songs. We approach our conversations with love, kindness, and curiosity to counter the prevalence of hate, anger, and judgment in the world. Our goal is that by listening to these stories, you can bring more love, kindness, and curiosity into your own life. With that, let's go have a listen together. Our guest today is Kim Segrave. Kimmy is a wife and mom who loves to push her physical boundaries and show her kids how to believe in themselves. She loves showing them how to be good humans through their thoughts and actions. A flight attendant based out of Australia, she loves a good mantra and affirmation. Kimmy, welcome to A Life in Six Songs.
Thanks for having me.
Oh, we're glad to be here. We're glad that you're here. I mean, we're glad that we're here too, obviously, but we're glad that you're here. And we're glad that we were able to make this work with us being in the States and you down under in Australia, that we're able to, you know, line it up and get you on. So let's go ahead and get into it. Before we get into your six songs, just to kind of warm us up and get us going, you know, what is it about music and the role that it plays in your life that wanted you to be a guest on this show? You know, kind of how do you see music fitting into your life?
Fitting into my life, it's like an everyday, you know, set the tone, set the mood. You can put it on, you know, if you're feeling down, bring you up. If I'm on my way to the gym, I can really get pumped by a certain song or feeling from a song.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Oh, I love that. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Carolina, who's going to get us going with your first question and your first song.
Ooh.
All right. So to start us off, I think it's so great. We hear lots of stories of folks when they were first exposed to like bands or artists and how it kind of rocked their world. And so for your first song, what's a memorable time for you when you were first exposed to a band or artist's music?
Well, I also did a lot of dancing when I was younger, so it was never really my selection of songs, but I was exposed to music. But my older sister, it would have been when she, Living on a Prayer, Bon Jovi, pumping out in the car, she really found that band. And then she snuck out of the house and went to their concert, got grounded for life. So I think for me that would make it really memorable. It was one of those ones when you were younger, really impressionable. And because of the story that she, you know, got grounded for life.
Absolutely. Let's take a quick listen and then we can chat some more on the other side. Here we go. Living on a Prayer. Bon Jovi. If you haven't heard this song, here it is. She says we gotta hold on to what we've got. It doesn't make a difference if we make it or not. We got each other, and that's a lot more love. We'll give it a shot. Oh, we're halfway there. Oh, give it all a prayer. Take my hand, we'll make it, I swear. Oh, give it all a prayer. How does it feel hearing it now?
Oh, it's actually, it's on the playlist in the gym at the moment. So we have like, you know, like I train every day and It's one of those things. And I could be mid anything. Anyone who does watch me on social media, like this song has been on our playlist and it comes on and that's it. I'm off. Like all the way. It's one of those things that just comes in and comes out, you know, like, I don't know, Bon Jovi. How can you not love him?
Absolutely.
Bon Jovi, especially this song, it sounds better, I think, now than it did even. It's like every year it gets better and better, the song. And this is from the 80s, right? This is from the glory days of glam metal.
80s, 90s. Let's get in there.
There you go. Late 80s. It gets better and better, though. I love this song.
Yeah. Absolutely. And like I said, you know, it doesn't matter where you are, like in the gym, it just comes on and it just comes out. Like you're fist pumping, you're like, turn to someone and you're like, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. When your older sister like shared this with you, was this like just a brand new like genre, or were you like kind of a little bit into this, but this was just something different? Sort of like, what was that experience like for you when you first heard it?
Well, like I said, when I was a like I did dancing and things like that. So it was more the classical side. Then you'd have like, you know, back in the 80s, the jazz sort of types of music. And then your older sister brings this like almost like rock band in, you know, and it's like, oh my gosh. And it still does for me today what it did back then. Like, you know, you just sort of, you can't help but move. You can't help but you jump around and all that sort of stuff and just have it, I don't know, your blood pumps faster and you, no matter when I listen to it, like I said, on the playlist right now, like even today in this class, it just went off.
Yeah. I think it's like totally one of those like feel good anthem type songs. They were doing an interview with John Bon Jovi here in the States. They recently released like a docuseries about his life and the band and stuff like that. And so he was doing interviews for it. And he talked about how he like suspects sometimes that he gets invited to weddings just because people want to hear him sing this song. And so like, they won't ask ahead of time. It'll be like mid wedding and people will be like, the band will start playing. It'll be like, come on, John. And he's like, damn it. And he obliges like every time. But I think, yeah, it's one of those songs that like, it just makes everyone feel really good. No matter what, you like crowd stand up, start fist pumping and singing it at the top of their lungs. Yeah, it's just good stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
So your sister got in trouble, but you came away with lifelong Bon Jovi fandom.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Fair trade, right?
Absolutely. And she, like, I mean, back in the 80s, big hair and everything. And I lived about an hour from Sydney on the train. So they all snuck out, jumped on a train, went to Sydney, went to the concert. I don't even know how she got tickets. Like she's, you know, sort of 8 years older than me. And she ended up getting the guitar pick. And for years she wore it around her neck. You know, and so to me, whoa, that's, yeah, like, I mean, like she got grounded for life, but she thought that was, you know, worth it.
So worth it. Absolutely.
No regrets there.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's those things when you're a kid that you know, you're going to get in trouble for, and you're just like, I'm doing it anyway, because what it is worth it. Like, yeah. I don't care what happens.
Exactly. Like, I mean, there's so many, the context of that now is just completely different. You would never sort of just go, I'm going to go on a train an hour away. I think they were like, they would have been 14 or 15, you know, sort of thing. But I think for me, that makes me sort of remember that time in my life because of the story as well. Mm-hmm. Not only the anthem to what it meant and the song and how you feel, but yeah, just almost like a rebel.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, I don't know how kids would do that nowadays, even with like, everyone's got cell phones and stuff and like you track them and stuff, like, you know, and our daughter does it to us too. Like, you know, like, you know, where it's just like we talked about, like it was a different time where you could do these types of things.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I also like too that it's like the song is Livin' on a Prayer, and we're talking about your older sister like doing this, like, yeah, she's living on a prayer, like, just like, we're gonna go to this concert and with a prayer, hope, you know, it goes all right, and the grounding isn't right. Too bad.
All right. So in keeping with the sort of spirit of music, like taking us back, you know, to good times or other times, sometimes music has like a really seared memory of a specific time or place. So for your next song, what is that song that like when you hear it, you're just instantly taken to that specific time or place?
It'd have to be Tomorrow by Silverchair. I actually went to school an hour away from where Silverchair went to school. And there was this thing called the Battle of the Bands. Okay. So our high school, their high school, you know, each month, I think it was, they would like send a group and they'd come and, you know, sort of, you know, it was, yeah, Battle of the Bands. So everyone would go up against it. It was a bit of I don't know if you call it a round robin, like when you compete against a group of, you know, teams or whatever. And so I have seen Silverchair before they were even on the world stage. And it just takes me back. But then there's songs, this particular one was also, you know, teenage years when unfortunate things happen. So that always sort of, whenever I hear it, it just, yeah, you sort of, you're taken straight back to that time. So not only do you feel like you know the band, but the song really resonated with, you know, some sad times.
Let's take a quick listen. I guarantee if you're watching the show right now and you're like, Silverchair Tomorrow, I don't know if I know that one. I guarantee if you're an elder millennial, Gen X, you will know this song, no matter where you were. I know in the States it was huge. So here we go, Silverchair.
There's no bathroom and there is no sink. The water out of the tap is very hard to drink. Maybe you have to drink.
How's it feel hearing it now?
Straight back to sitting in that, you know, school hall. We had an elevated stage and they were just kids, you know, just having a band and that sort of thing. But then, so this one, there was a big car accident and it took three of my friends, you know, they were only young, year 11, which is our second last year. And it was, That time they were coming from one of these battle of vans, you know, so they'd sort of jam out and play. The car was overloaded, you know, the horror stories we hear and hopefully our children have learned from things like this. So there were three of them. That was really sad. And then there was another one who couldn't see it out by himself. So we all know without sort of saying how that ended, but so this song, this band, you know, a good and a sad response to the memories of it.
Absolutely.
I remember these guys were super young themselves, the band members. I remember it was right around the sort of alternative sort of wave. You know, I'm sure we've all heard about the sort of the curse of the age 27, right? Which is Jim Morrison, Janis Joplin, Kurt Cobain. And so these guys, I remember, came out right around the time of the sort of alternative rock music, but they were younger. They were like 10 years younger than the Kurt Cobains and then the other sort of alternative bands back then. So they fully represented that sort of teen, you know, rebellion, angst, and all of that. And I'm sorry about the story that's attached to it for you. You know, it's a really, you know, it's a really sad one.
Yeah, yeah. And as the funny thing is, I don't know if you know how much behind Silverchair, they actually come from a town called Morisset, which is near Newcastle, sort of an hour south of Newcastle, but an hour north of where I grew up. And there was a mental asylum there. So that the music that was coming out always had that sort of stigma that these guys, you know, were really troubled. And well written when you listen to the lyrics. It actually tells it tells a story from their soul, sort of thing. But I think because they come from that town where that had that stigma around it, it makes a very interesting sort of, and then they obviously, went crazy and everyone knows who they are.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. I love that too. And I appreciate you sharing the story of the loss and the tragedy. I mean, it's one of those things where, unfortunately, a lot of us have similar stories like that, right? Mm. Around those times. And like you said, it, when you're in those teen years, young 20s, like you said, people are traveling together in groups, in cars and things. So when something, a car crash or something happens, we tend to lose a number of people in it at that time, right? Like you said, you've got bands traveling together, sports teams, whatever it might be. And so it always makes it like that much harder because of that, So thank you for sharing that. And thank you for sharing the geography aspect of where they were from and relation to you. We joke on this show that we're a music podcast, but we also are like a pseudo kind of like geography. Cause we talk like we're always somewhere when we're listening to music and the cousin who introduces us to a song comes from somewhere. And so this music is always tied to us and experiences, but always tied to a place too, in that sense. And so I appreciate you sharing that aspect of it.
Well, Australia has a really awesome sort of connection to rock music, I think specifically. I mean, it doesn't get any more sort of, better connected than like AC/DC, for example, right?
Absolutely. I mean, lots of memories there, being an 80s kid, that your parents would just put the cassette in the old Commodore car, which you guys wouldn't know. It was like a GM for you guys. Everyone had one, these Commodore cars, and they'd put the cassette in and, play it until it was stretched.
Yeah, absolutely.
That was a thing. You could play a cassette too much to where like the tape would get thin and then it would unravel and you'd have to take a pencil and the things people don't have to do anymore.
Yeah. Absolutely. Like they'd have no idea. Like when they release a song here in Australia, you guys would get it and it literally would have to be shipped. Like the CDs or the records or the cassettes would have to be shipped to Australia and then, broadcast or whatever. I think I get to it later. I don't think. But recording on your boombox from the top 100, because we didn't have live stream. We didn't have just buy the song and those sorts of things. I was discussing with my mom about this and she said she skipped school to actually when the Beatles came to Australia. And she remembers and she remembers getting the record. She used all of her money, to save her money. And she bought this one, and she said it was a little tiny, a tiny record, but they basically had to bring that to Australia when they were coming because it wasn't, just a quick download sort of thing. So, music is just, it's leaps and bounds and how much closer I feel with everyone, doing something like this.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm finding it super interesting that your mom did kind of what your sister did. Like, it's so hard then. You have kids and they do like the shit you did and you're like, damn, I want to be mad at you. But I also did that too, I can't let you get away with it. So like, you're grounded for life.
Yeah, for life.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, so true. Oh, it's a great story.
All right. For our next song, sometimes we have music that is just intimately tied to like a specific activity when we're doing them, a book, a trip you took. What is a song for you that's intimately tied to some kind of activity?
So the one that really comes to mind is I worked in a summer camp, which is how I have met, gotten to know you guys over the years through people. I came to summer camp in North Carolina. I was the tennis instructor. Tennis instructor. And it was these courts that were like at the top end of the camp. And oh my gosh, they were as boring as batshit. I hadn't been exposed to Walmart. So I ducked over to Walmart and bought a boombox, and CDs were just coming out, and Matchbox 20 was the CD that we blasted all summer from the back of the court just to have some atmosphere up there, because we're kind of up in the hill part of this camp. And the kids found it hilarious, and it just takes me right back to that activity. And then, like, obviously, awesome. I've got gyms and comps that I do and things like that. But this one would have to be, as soon as you hear it, it takes me straight back to that tennis court with those little kids who are probably grown adults right now.
let's go back to that tennis court. Matchbox 20, 3 a.m.
And she only sleeps when it's raining. And she screams and her voice is straining. Says, baby, when it's 3 a.m., I must be lonely. Heaven, she says, baby, yeah. Well, I can't help but be scared of it all sometimes.
So how old were you when you were doing this camp?
I was 18. So I'd finished all of my schooling here in Australia, jumped on a flight straight over there, and went straight to this summer camp. And I ended up doing it for about 4 years in a row. So you got to know these kids quite well.
There is something about this song. Like, I don't know. It takes me like immediately back to a college bar. Mm-hmm. When I was like, there is something. And I think that's what the song's about. But like, there's just something about this song that like places you at places in your life. It doesn't feel like a casual song you just listen to on the radio. It's like seared into people, I feel like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Cause you couldn't escape this song, right? It was so like kind of everywhere. Yeah. And I don't mean that in a bad way, like, oh, it was, but like everybody has a connection, I think, to this song in some way, because it was just so kind of everywhere. Like if you were the right age, let's say, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
So yeah. Everybody's probably got a place it puts you with this one.
Yeah, I remember I was at UF when I first heard this song, and Matchbox 20, I think they were from Orlando. So there was, and we were up in sort of slightly north of Orlando, but it was still like a Florida, state of Florida type connection. And then right after this song is when Rob Thomas, the singer, went solo, and he had that huge hit with the with Carlos Santana.
Oh, wow.
But this song, like you said, it was everywhere. It was completely, you know, it blew up. It was on VH1 back when VH1 used to be a thing. And then pretty soon after that, it was all about Rob Thomas, and he just sort of went solo. But yeah, it was a good song. I like this one.
He was super cute. I totally had a crush on Rob Thomas. Yeah.
So, I did not. So
you could, but wasn't your jam?
It wasn't my jam.
So
he was
Kimmy,
busy
was
crushing
this,
on James Hetfield.
Was this was this just a random CD you all picked up, or like you knew who Matchbox 20 was and you found it at the Walmart?
I think I found it at the Walmart. Like it was just, it was one of those things. And I think I hadn't heard it. I don't think, like I said, Australia got things later, even the CD things we got a lot later than you guys. Mm-hmm. And I would have gone from our summer to your summer. So some, like now the whole thing is completely different, as in, things come out for our summer so that they can haul it over to your summer as well, like an anthem, you know what I mean? Like a song that might, be something good in Vegas. They sort of think, okay, this is going to be our summer anthem for whatever year, and they bring it out here first to see if it really takes off as well. But
right,
there's no time lapse.
You kind of get to, Yeah. Yeah. You get to check it out.
Like a test market.
In the Southern Hemisphere summer before you send it to the Northern Hemisphere summer. Yeah.
Yeah. Or sometimes I think they might like release something for your summer. And if it really takes off, then they really sort of, you know, bring it down under.
Right.
I mean, we do know someone who might know the answer to that, you know. Roz?
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to plead the fifth on this one. Sorry, guys.
I sort of was implying Mr. Tim. Mr. Tim might know.
Oh, right. Yeah. I mean, he's, you know, we have a mutual friend, basically. And I think we'll get to the story there. The encyclopedia of music. And I think especially things like things that we can really nerd out on from a music perspective. Yeah.
Nice.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, yeah. Phone a friend.
Yeah.
So like, I mean, like I said, you know, sometimes it comes out here first and then it didn't really take off, but then I see it in America and I'm like, oh my gosh, you guys love this. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you found this CD, because like, I don't know what would have happened if you would have found some like horrible music that you all hated and then you were like stuck listening to it all summer. So like, absolutely. Not bad.
Yeah. I lucky it wasn't a cassette, because it would have been warped by the end of the summer.
Right. Especially sitting outside in a boombox, you know, in the heat of the summer, would have just melted.
Well, yeah, that was North Carolina, a little cooler than Florida, but yes, still hot.
Was North Carolina your first exposure to coming to America, like to the States?
No, I actually danced for Disney when I first finished high school here. I went over with a troupe and applied for a job dancing for Disney. So I was there for 6 months and then came straight across for your summer in North Carolina, met some friends, moved to Florida, hung out with them, worked a little down there, and then went back to North Carolina, and it went on for a couple of years. So it was kind of the second experience. The first one, I kind of did go a bit nuts, you know, when you land in Anaheim and check it all out, as you do.
Yeah, for sure, nice, for sure. Nice.
Well, it is the happiest place on earth, so.
Well, yeah, it is. Yeah, I did go back there with another mutual friend probably 5 years ago, and it had changed quite a bit, but it still had that undertone, so that's good.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff. All right. Well, thinking now to just other aspects of life and music, sometimes music can be there kind of as a friend when times are tough. And so for your next song, Kimmy, what's a song that helped you through a really difficult time or situation?
Okay. I'm going to have to apologize in advance. I lost my dad 5 years ago, well, coming up to 5 years ago, and it was a typical response for Australia, melanoma, skin cancer, but that actually was on his brain, and, you know, it literally, he was diagnosed in the February and gone in the October. So rapid. But every time I used to, he lived about an hour away from where I live. And my kids were little. I would put them in the back of the car, drive out there because my mom had dropped him and, you know, she couldn't lift him, she couldn't do stuff, or we'd go out to visit him or whatever. You just do what you do. And I would never change it. You know, I think I did what I could and as much as I could, sort of thing. But every time I would leave there, the Guy Sebastian song Choir would play. Now that is also, if you listen to the lyrics and I researched it, Guy Sebastian actually wrote it for a friend who took his own life. So it kind of was about death, but being beautiful and reuniting and things like that. But every time, and whenever I think of my dad, that song within like 10 minutes will come on. Like just all of a sudden, you know, so just an amazing little, you know, I don't know. And I the first bit gets me, chokes me up. I just start to sort of, and then I sort of overcome with like, almost gratitude and release and relief that you can let go and just sing through the song. I am the world's worst singer, but, you know, and sing along with it and just sort of sit in that space.
Yeah. Let's take a listen. I think I have the chorus pulled up is the clip we're going to listen to. So.
Gets you every time.
What does it feel like hearing it?
Just what? I know it's going to sound really corny, but like you're sitting there. I think because the song is written about dying and suicide, and I don't know, it just resonates. Makes you cry. But yeah, just as if like he's there saying, it's okay, I gotcha. I'm here.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I the way you describe the song too, and it's like not a lot of songs can do kind of what this song does. You know, I encourage everyone to go, you know, find the song and listen to the whole thing, because like Kimmy, you said, the first verse is the tough part, right? It's about the loss, and it's like the music is different. And then it like, and so it gets you into that moment like, okay, we are talking about loss and, you know, these difficult issues. And then the chorus hits and it's got this like lift to it where, you know, it's like, hey, I lost you and I miss you, but hey, I know you're up there. I know I'm going to see you soon. No, those kinds of things. And so, yeah, just a really powerful, powerful song for that.
Yeah.
I think it definitely requires another listen for some of us who haven't heard this one before, because as I was listening to that clip, it sounded like those songs where there's sort of a duality to them. The lyrics are one way, but the music is something else, right? The music, especially in the clip that we heard, the music definitely sounds uplifting and sort of, you know, joyous and almost like a celebration.
But
obviously when you say that it's tied to something like grief and loss and things like that, it takes you to a different, it has different meaning. But yeah.
Yeah. And when I kept hearing the song at that point when I'd drive home from my mom and dad's, or any point when I heard it, I didn't know until I sort of researched it, that was actually about his best mate that actually took his own life. So, it's music's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that can be some hot times just thinking about, the subject matter, but the way the artist chose to do it, right? How David's saying that the song starts out more somber and then gets more uplifting. Like that's kind of how grief is, you know, there's like this missing piece and then there's this like remembering fondly piece. And then, you know, it's not always sad. It comes in waves and comes and goes and ups and downs, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And some days I can choke up in the first line and then I'm completely fine. And then other times I just hear it and it just, you know, you just cry.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
And, well, and another Australian artist.
Oh. Yeah.
Yes, the little bit of music trivia. Yeah. Guy Sebastian won the first season of Australian Idol in 2003. So yeah. For all of and us he... US folks, that's
And he actually he's not musically trained from what I remember. He was self-taught. He actually came from a very religious family where music was taboo. And he was not allowed to do it unless it was a Christian, you know, music and things like that. And then he managed to break away from that. So I think he's an amazing man, amazing character. He writes, you know, and just the philosophy behind him and, you know, like I follow him on social media and things like that, and his wife, they're just really a beautiful people, and they've got that balance now between their religion, their home life, their music, their family life.
Mm.
I think, mm-hmm. you know, if you're watching this guy, I think you've got it balanced.
Yeah. Nice. And it makes the music better when you kind of like the artist, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. He has gone away from the big fro he had when he won Idol. So, yeah, worth a watch.
Will do.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Everyone go check out that first season of Australian Idol, and we'll see Guy Sebastian winning it all.
Right. Was it Simon Cowell over there too in that version? I may be getting the shows wrong.
I'm trying to think back. I think he did do the first one.
Okay.
Hmm.
I think, yeah, yeah. It sort of came out here.
Yeah.
I think Marsha Hines, who's another Australian one, I've got a feeling she was the first. Yeah, don't hold me to it.
No worries.
Yeah, no worries. Okay. Exactly.
So we'll take a bit of a pivot here to something lighthearted that makes you feel really good. What is a song from a movie that is seared into your mind? You can't think of the movie without thinking about the song, and vice versa.
Oh my gosh. There are so many. But it'd have to be recently. I Can't Stop That Feeling by Justin Timberlake from the Trolls movie. I have a vehicle that has a video, like a TV screen in the ceiling. And obviously driving between my dad and our house, that sort of thing was an hour. The children watched that movie over and over and over, but it also made you feel better and happier sort of thing coming out of there. I have never seen the movie, but I could recite it.
That's hilarious. I've only heard the movie. I haven't seen the movie.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I love that.
Love
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and it's just one of those you can't not feel happy when it comes on, sort of thing.
Absolutely. Yeah, let's take a listen and I'll feel happy. Nothing I can see but you when you dance, feel good creeping up on you, so just dance, come on. All those things I shouldn't do, but you dance, and ain't nobody leaving soon, so keep dancing. So just dance.
So just dance.
Ooh,
yeah,
amen for children's movies that have good soundtracks, because I feel like when we were little, they were terrible. And now they like make a real effort. And it just makes the movie so much better.
Oh, absolutely. Mm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. One day it
makes it easier on the parents.
Yeah.
Totally, because we're stuck with whatever our kids are watching over and over on repeat, and when it sucks, that makes just for a harder time for parents. So,
and
amen
some of them,
for this soundtrack.
And some of them never, like, this always makes you feel happy, but sometimes you hear that song in a child's movie and you're like, I want to break that record, or you know, stop downloading it.
Yes.
Because you're like, okay, it was great for the first million times. Now I'm
right.
Yeah. But this one, no. Yes. This one always makes you feel good.
There's a period of time, I guess, in the last, I don't know, maybe 10 years or so, where it's like one animated movie after the other. And for some reason, the soundtracks have just been amazing. I think the Trolls movie was one. There was one, I think it was Inside Out.
Yes.
And there was another one called Soul. I think actually Trent Reznor did the movie, did some of the music for that. But yeah, it's like one after the other. Even the Disney movies, and then they come up with these really amazing soundtracks to go along with them. You hire the pop stars to get in, give it some gravitas. It's amazing.
And on different levels. You know, the kids get it here and the parents get it here.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
100%.
I like that.
Well, the test is if I can stay awake through the first 15 minutes, it's a hit, usually. So...
Do you are you a faller or a sleeper in movies?
Dude, terrible. I'm terrible. I am horrible.
Oh my goodness.
And my kids make so much fun of me, especially when they were younger. They had this whole routine. They're like, oh yeah, dad, as soon as the Universal, you know, Universal Studios.
Oh,
like,
sure.
Dad, as soon as the Universal Studios credit comes up, he's out cold. And they make so much fun of me.
That's hilarious.
Oh my gosh, Raza. Oh yeah.
And give me something from like 1983 and I will watch it, you know, on repeat, no problem. A newer cartoon, out cold.
Oh my goodness.
Kimmy, thank you for sharing this one, and I'm so glad this came up in your questionnaire, and we have it here in the show in the interview, because it just speaks to, you know, the whole premise of what we're trying to get at with our show here, of like how music just is there and can be so powerful and lock us into a moment and things. And so, you know, I love how this, you know, came up, and it's this memory of music that's in you, but tied to you and your kids, right? It's this moment where it's like, that usually can be so like frustrating and challenging, right? Driving the kids in the car and like, you know, and they're unhappy or they're frustrated, they're tired, they're hungry, whatever. And it's like, here's this kind of, you know, song that is locked into this happy moment for it. And so I just really appreciate the story. So thank you.
Love that. All right. Well, we have arrived at your last song. And for this one, I think we haven't, I don't know that we've had this, a guest answer this particular question yet. So I'm super pumped about it. It's, what's a song that reminds you of just a good friend or a group of friends?
Oh, I have known these two people for over half my life. I met them when I came to America and introduced through someone. And then I was there the day that they met each other. And now they're happily married with kids and everything. And this is how I know Raza. And these two are just, they are the brother and sister that you just, you know, you didn't, that you were meant to have. You were meant to have. But, yeah, my best friend, Jen, she's like, and my mum used to say when she had met Jen coming out to Australia, she is just you, but on the other side of the world. And we are just so alike. It's unbelievable. But it's a song called by Zedd, Meet in the Middle, which obviously, well, Tim works in music as well. So it is kind of ironic, but every time I hear it, I saw it on our national news TV, and they were doing a project, which was very ironic, of an aeroplane. And they were talking about how it was being built together, and they used this song. And I happened to record it, like screen record it, and I sent it to Jen, who was sitting next to Zedd, and showed him. And it just, yeah, so it blew my mind. She was on the plane, on a plane in America next to him, who's the song, I think he composed and wrote and everything like that. And here they were talking about, like, because his aeroplane was being met in the middle, like, and they were building it.
Yeah.
So then, like, you know, like, it's every time I just hear it, I just see those two, and yeah, it just fills my heart.
That's awesome. Let's take a listen.
Why don't you come on over? I can't just let you go.
It's like the definition of a catchy fucking song. Like, it just comes on. When I was getting the clip ready for you know, this episode now, and just listening to it, I'm just like, man, that's catchy.
So good. Yeah.
Okay.
So where do your friends live now?
The ones from the States?
The ones that this reminds you of. Yeah. Oh,
yeah, they're in Florida.
Okay. Okay. Oh, so like across the world from you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking about the song because I think you said you had met them in the States. And so when then I was listening to the words and the chorus and I was like, why don't you just meet me in the middle? And I was like, do you all like fly somewhere, like meet up in the middle?
Yes, we do. And Jen and I are meeting up in the middle in Hawaii next month.
I love that.
So that's yeah. Awesome. Yeah. But like I said, we've been friends for over half our life with, you know, you sort of go, whoa, our, you know, like, yeah, children, our everything. But yeah, just those people that you hear a song and it takes you to them. And because the song is a lot closer to them as well. So has right. quite a lot of meaning.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. The song's great. I love the song. I think, and you know, for a while it was everywhere. It was, I mean, I could walk into like a mall. I remember walking into like a doctor's office, and oh yeah, there's Zedd playing again. Fantastic. Yeah, it's a great song. It's a happy song.
It is, isn't it? Yeah, it's one of those all time. I think it will go down as a bit of an anthem.
Hmm.
And I was just thinking back through your six. I mean, you've had quite a few anthems, and I think there's certainly like an anthemic theme to this episode, is what I'm getting at.
Yeah.
Starting but with really, "Livin' on a Prayer," which is the anthem of all anthems. You know, the bar yeah. song and the all of that to then all the way through into this one. Yeah.
Yeah.
The Love anthem it. Episode.
The anthem episode.
That's right. Yeah, that's what we'll call it.
That's right. And in the gym, it's the music comes on, and especially if it's that older sort of stuff, people automatically just look at me and they know that I'm gonna go crazy, or I'm gonna start jumping around, because I'm one of those people that dance like no one's watching, you know, like I don't really mind too much, but I feel it. It moves me, especially if it means something to me. Yeah, like that "Living on a Prayer," like I'm 45 and it's still from something from when I was like, I think I was about 8 or 9, you know, like moves me right here.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So I have to ask a question. So, and this goes back to your intro, right? So we know that you're very, very much into, you know, fitness and sort of gym active and everything. But other than that, I you know, we mentioned, you know, you have sort of a flying connection of sorts, but then there's also another connection that we didn't mention, which is on all your socials, which is the sort of, you know, amazing art, like baking art was what I'm going to call it, cake art, right? So I would love for you to elaborate on that a little bit, but also what's the music connection, if any, to the baking art world? I mean, do you put on sort of happy songs to get you inspired? Is it on like a case by case type thing? So talk to us about that a little bit.
I make art out of cake, and people always say, oh, what do you do? You know, like, aren't you sad when they eat it? And I'm like, no. Means that they're going to buy more. it's not like a painting, you know, sort of thing. But I love to shock people and push my boundaries with that. So I make artwork out of cake and for all types of things. But when I'm cooking, all my cakes take usually 3 to 4 days to make. So regardless of the size or anything like that, it's just the process that I go through. It does depend on the style of cake. Sometimes, most of the time, I'd probably just put like country radio on, you know, and Morgan Wallace, you know, just sort of nice, nothing too fast, because I don't want to rush things, sort of thing. But yeah, sometimes it, you know, I'll put something that will get me really, you know, revved up for it or whatever. But yeah, more inclined with what the cake might be.
Oh, that's super cool.
That's awesome.
Well, sorry, I'm having a moment because I'm trying to think of you like baking, but like it totally makes sense sometimes when you're doing something that you get into like the flow of, you get lost in something.
Mm-hmm.
And like the music sort of has to go with that feeling. Otherwise, it'll like break you from your process, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And especially like if I'm hand painting something on a cake, it's kind of final. Once you put it on there, it's not coming off. You can't really erase it. So you kind of have to be pretty precise. And, you know, sometimes like if I have something fast on, my heart will be going faster and things like that. But I find the country music is my even keel.
It's like baking tempo.
Yeah.
Unless I'm and within so, Ganache. Yeah. I'll send you a clip, but I like to whip my ganache to make the sides of my cake and things like that. And then before I put the fondant on. So I usually have it in like a sort of a smallish sort of bowl. And I will be sitting there whipping away. And you're like, whipping.
So then it's something a little bit more aggressive, yes. A little bit more intense maybe.
If I'm ganaching a cake, yes, sometimes I will crank it up.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I was almost thinking of like I know there's some shows like sort of doctor themed shows, but like the cool doctors before they perform like the most intense surgery, they'll always pop in, you know, some sort of musical number. Yeah. Some doctors would go for, you know, sort of classical music. And my favorite doctors go for death metal. So, I'm kidding. But
I'm sure they're out there.
I don't know that
if I'm on the table, that's what I want coming on. Like, I better be asleep when it starts playing.
Totally.
But I'm sure it's out there.
You get a lot when they're delivering babies. They'll do the same.
Oh, sure.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That totally makes sense. Yeah.
The playlist and what music to go. Yeah, for sure.
That's hilarious.
Love that.
Well, I'm going to have to definitely check out your social media and like the baking and stuff. Like that sounds fascinating.
Yeah. And we'll link it all in the show notes and
everything. Yeah, sure. Clips and
yeah, for sure.
Clips and links.
All right. Kimmy, we have reached the end of your 6 songs. How is like one of my favorite questions at the end of this, but like, how does it feel hearing your life reflected through music and through these 6 songs?
At first I thought it was going to be difficult to narrow it down to 6 songs because music is such a big thing. But when you really hone in on the importance and the why, which I'm doing a lot of research on at the moment, the why you have something happen to you, the why you do something, I kind of answered it with thinking about my why, you know, my children in the music, in the movies, they're my why, you know. That was my why at the time of watching some movies that I actually think about the music. So I sort of think it was kind of quick, but yeah, straight to the point. And it really brought all those back to a really great place.
Nice. I love that. All right. So we like to finish out on a fun rapid fire note. Raza is going to lead you through your lightning round.
Wow.
Yeah, lightning round time.
Oh,
okay.
Gosh.
So it's a lightning round. We like to keep it, you know, short and sweet, but basically very simple. So we would love to know what was your first, your last, and your best or favorite concert. So first concert, last concert, and best or favorite.
Please don't judge me on the moment, okay? First concert.
No judgment.
No judgment allowed on this show.
The first
come to the right place.
Yep.
The first concert was John Farnham, because I am Australian. John Farnham. It was in a field. Just a field sort of thing. And I think tickets were like $15. Nice. Last concert, it has been a while. I couldn't even tell you. Probably being in Vegas with you, Raza, in the club. That it's not really a concert, but that was probably the last time I sort of, you know, big musical Zeb. And my best would probably be Vegas. So, yeah, that's as close as you get to a concert for me at the moment.
Yeah.
That's true. Nice. Who did you see in Vegas?
Zedd.
Oh, Zedd. Oh. Sorry, I missed that. Okay, got it. Awesome.
There you go.
All yeah, right.
Love it.
Vegas is hard to top. You know, in any way.
Yeah.
For sure.
And now they've like upped it with the sphere. So like, I don't even know now, like you go to a concert and it like melts your brain. Like, I don't even know what happens going to see a show at the sphere.
Yeah. Crazy. Craziness.
Yeah.
Love it.
That's our next trip. So, okay.
There we go.
Well, I need an excuse. I think we all could use, you know, a, I'd recommend anyone try and get down to Australia. So, I mean, one of my sort of, you know, life dream, life goal, bucket list trips is, you know, watching the Sydney Opera House, you know, from the from the windows of a Qantas plane. So
absolutely. We can fix that up for you, Raza.
Definitely.
It's true. You might know somebody.
Yeah.
And a round of cricket. I'm sorry. I just have to do it.
Mm. We can find that.
Cool. Done.
And see a rugby match. That'd be cool.
Yeah.
Adding to this itinerary as we go.
The trip is getting longer and longer.
Absolutely.
We'll add some kangaroos. Why not?
All right. Well, Kimmy, in the last few couple of minutes we have left, the floor is yours to tell our audience, you know, anything you've got going on that you think folks might be interested in, where they can follow you if you have social media that's public. Like, your floor is yours to share what you got going on.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. At the moment my life is revolving around the kids' work, but a new phenomenon called the high rocks. So yeah, so everyone get out there, do something for yourself, make yourself feel good. You can compete and push yourself, or just to compete to say you did it. And that's just amazing. So yeah, it's a world phenomenon and I'm loving it. We'll see how we go. Some are competitive, some aren't. That's my whole focus at the moment. And believe it or not, Instagram, I do all my cakes and everything, but I do post my my workouts and things like that as well. So, yeah, you can find me there.
Awesome. Awesome. And we'll have all of that linked down in the show notes for people to check out and find you. So you can see workout routines and cake art and maybe some traveling and some airplane shots and things,
yeah,
too.
That's right. Yeah. Awesome. I finished at midnight last night, so sorry about the bags.
Ooh.
Oh,
life of a
rough shift.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, Kimmy, thank you so much for being on. We really appreciated hearing your story. Thank you for coming to us and, you know, scheduling halfway around the world is a challenge. Luckily we have the technology to do it. And I'm so glad we were able to make this happen. So thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. All right, everyone out there, you know what to do. Like, subscribe, follow, whatever channel, whatever way you're watching or listening to this episode. If you like what you're hearing and you want to hear more stories, make sure to do all that so you hear future episodes. And we will see you next time on A Life in Six Songs.